Good afternoon, everyone. It's been a long day for all of you. I'm Robert Schlossman. I'm one of the myeloma doctors at Dana-Farber. Some of you may know me. Weekends, I don't wear a tie, just for the record. I'm going to go through, we'll do a question and answer session. I have a bunch of questions. If anyone else has questions that they haven't passed up, please see that I get them. I'll start with the first question, which is, many of the multiple drug combinations include dexamethasone. What alternatives are there for patients with serious dexamethasone side effects, such as diabetes? Dexamethasone is a very important drug that we use. My feeling is that a little bit of dexamethasone is better than no dexamethasone. So, you know, I don't like to admit it completely. For people that have serious side effects, it really depends on the side effect. I think we have this growing appreciation that elevated blood sugars do contribute to people feeling poorly, and we hope to coordinate with our endocrine service in terms of managing sugars. You know, they're the obvious recommendations, which are dietary, you know, to avoid concentrated sweets on the days that you take the dexamethasone. I think for some people, we may need to do a better job making sure that people's glucose remains below 120. It's always a little bit challenging to aggressively manage sugars with people cycling on and off of steroids because there's a greater risk of the sugars going too low. We do use prednisone. For some people, that may be better tolerated. And like any drug, there may be situations where we do have to admit the drug completely. Revlimid and dex versus Revlimid without dex or Velcade for maintenance. You know, I think you've probably heard from my colleagues that there has been this trend to continuous therapy. And I think in the old days, we would treat to a minimal disease state with or without transplant and then follow people, and when their disease progressed by numbers, resume chemotherapy. I think there's growing data from the Palumbo trial, from our transplant studies looking at the role of Revlimid, from earlier French studies looking at the role of thalidomide, that it's very important to continue medications as maintenance, and that when you sequence these drugs and continue them, that the outcomes translate to a better progression-free survival, and in many of the studies, longer overall survival. I think what we're trying to do is figure out what the optimal combinations are. In the CLGB-sponsored study looking at Revlimid versus placebo, the Revlimid was single agent given every day. And for some of you who are on that study, you know, the missing the week off from Revlimid can translate to issues with counts. I think we're trying to work out the optimum combinations. They may be different for different people. One of the strategies that we like to use now in the non-protocol setting is to use risk stratification to guide the maintenance regimen. For example, for individuals with standard risk disease based on cytogenetics or ISS staging, we use single-agent Revlimid. For people with more aggressive disease, we tend to favor more aggressive maintenance. So for example, if someone goes to transplant with an adverse chromosomal marker, one of the things that we like to do based on a number of studies is to give that individual 90 to 100 days to recover from the transplant, and then rather than go right to single agent Revlimid maintenance, give chemotherapy as consolidation. Typically, the Velcade-based triplet that we use to get them to the transplant, and that can include another 2 to 4 cycles of Revlimid Velcade dexamethasone or Cytoxan Velcade dexamethasone. That's what we refer to as consolidation. And then continue the Velcade-based triplet as maintenance. And when we convert it to a maintenance portion, we often adjust the schedule so that it's more convenient. So for example, my Revlimid Velcade dexamethasone maintenance regimen, I convert the cycle to a 28-day cycle. The Velcade's given every 2 weeks. The Revlimid is given days 1 through 21. And the dexamethasone is given with the same days that people receive the Velcade. And we can do the same thing with Cytoxan as well. Before relapse, if we add new therapies to Revlimid dexamethasone therapy, will it prevent mutations longer? I think, you know, one of the things that we've also learned is that more drugs are better than fewer drugs. And I think looking at the data for single agent activity, if you look at the active drugs, it typically runs 30 to 40%. If you look at two drug combinations, typically a novel agent plus dexamethasone, response rates range from 60 to 96%. And when you look at three drug combinations, response rates can be close to 100%. So I do think that more drugs are better. The rationale behind these combinations is that these drugs target different signaling pathways that myeloma cells used to continue to grow, to prevent damage. And I think that the more drugs that target more different pathways makes it harder for new clones to arise. What is the pharmacologic action of dexamethasone? So by itself, dexamethasone is a highly active agent. In the old days, before many of my colleagues in the group, we used a lot of single agent dexamethasone. And at the time that I started focusing on this disease, the recipes that we used were melphalan and prednisone, or something called VBMCP, or VAD. But at the time, we also used a lot of single agent dexamethasone, typically in higher doses than we use now. The standard dose was based on the VAD regimen, where we would give dexamethasone 40 milligrams a day, days 1 through 4, 9 through 12, and 17 through 20. We know that steroids, usually the families bore the brunt of this, but sometimes that was brought to the clinic as well. But, you know, that's a pretty toxic recipe, and, you know, we've been trying to get away from that to try to reduce some of the side effects associated with dexamethasone. But we know that dexamethasone triggers programmed cell death pathways in myeloma cells. We call that apoptosis. We know that it can affect caspases, which are proteins that these cells use to protect themselves from toxic injury. There are a lot of different mechanisms. The other principle here is something called synergy, meaning that the combinations work better than the sum of the parts. And these are some of the principles of targeting multiple different pathways in the myeloma cell. Should non-transplant people with myeloma be treated with RVD light beyond maintenance regimen? How do you decide which maintenance drugs? One of our upfront studies is RVD light. Getting back to the issue of toxicities, the rationale behind RVD light is to give the drugs in a less intense way. And what we're trying to see is if we can control the disease in an effective fashion with less toxicity. There's nothing that prevents people on RVD light from going to transplant, but I think if someone is eligible and highly motivated to proceed to transplant in first or second remission, then we would recommend that they consider more aggressive therapy. In terms of maintenance, I think that maintenance is whatever therapy you do once someone plateaus in a minimal disease state. And I think if we feel that someone is appropriate for RVD light, then it's very reasonable to consider a single agent Revlimid as the maintenance afterwards. Now, other things can factor into which drugs we use for maintenance. Velcade is probably as active, if not more active, maintenance drug. Its big disadvantage is that it's intravenous or sub-Q. And when we do go to a maintenance schedule with Velcade, I typically give it every 2 weeks, which is more convenient than giving it twice a week for 2 weeks, but it's certainly less convenient than coming in once a month while you're on single agent Revlimid. Some patients are on dexamethasone maintenance because they can't tolerate Revlimid or Velcade. So we do, you know, we do try to tailor therapy for the individual and what drugs they tolerate. And as you heard from Dr. Avigan, you know, one of the other exciting strategies will be to, you know, get people into a minimal disease state and then to try to manipulate their immune system as the maintenance. I think that, as you've probably heard earlier today, there are even newer and more exciting drugs. You know, we're very excited about Iaxamib, which is an oral proteasome inhibitor made by Millennium. They get very upset if you call it oral Velcade. They think it's a different drug. But that certainly would allow us to put someone on basically Iaxamib, Revlimid, and dexamethasone as a maintenance. So it's basically like RVD maintenance with three oral drugs. And assuming that that individual tolerates the combination and their counts hold up, then that's potentially a once-a-month visit. Come in once a month for the Zometa, to have your counts checked, to have your prescriptions renewed, and then you're on your way. Is the monoclonal antibody rituximab ever used in treating myeloma? We did, a number of years ago, one of our colleagues, Dr. Treon, looked at rituximab in myeloma. Rituximab is a drug that's very commonly used in lymphomas, which is a related disorder. It's also used as an immune modulator in autoimmune disorders. It targets a structure on the surface of lymphocytes called CD20. Myeloma is considered a more mature cell in the B-cell development, and most myeloma cells do not express CD20. So that's typically why we don't use it. When we've looked at it in myeloma, part of the thought was that, well, maybe the earlier sort of the immature cells in that clone express CD20, and that was the basis for one of our studies. And unfortunately, we did not see a significant response. There are individuals who have lymphoproliferative disorders with features of both myeloma and lymphoma. And if we have someone whose cells are behaving funny, we will flow them for to see what structures are on their surface. And if that person does have CD20 expressing plasma cells, then we will, and the usual drugs are not working as well as we want, in that situation, we would consider adding rituximab. Rituximab is a monoclonal antibody. It's not completely benign. It is very immunosuppressive. It can activate hepatitis in someone with hepatitis. So it's not, you know, it's not without risk. Should people with myeloma get the Prevnar 13 vaccination? We do recommend that at diagnosis that everyone is updated with their routine vaccinations. We know that in myeloma, because of the monoclonal antibody and the suppression of normal antibodies, that people are at increased risk of infections, not just routine infections, but opportunistic infections. And I think it's very important that everyone is up to date with their vaccinations, and that includes seasonal influenza vaccine. We rely most on antibodies to clear encapsulated organisms, so some bacteria have thick polysaccharide coats, and when other cells in the immune system try to engulf them, they kind of squirt out. So we do, in that setting, we rely on antibodies coating the sort of the bacteria and allowing other cells in the immune system to clear that infection more rapidly. So we do recommend that everyone's updated with their immunizations. The other setting that we recommend vaccinations is post-transplant. So we have a very standard vaccination schedule after transplant starting at 9 months. So we have a series of immunizations at 9 months, 12 months, 18 months, and 24 months. It does include the flu. So there is the live attenuated vaccines, we like to wait until the 24-month period. For people that are 0 to 3 months out from transplant, we don't often recommend the flu shot. It is a recombinant shot, so we're not worried about toxicity unless someone's allergic to thimerosal or egg products. In that setting, it's very important that the patient's family and close contacts are vaccinated. For between 3 and 6 months, we'll give the vaccine, but it's unlikely that that person may have a meaningful response, so you can't assume that it's an effective vaccine. After 6 months, we do vaccinate. We do assume that there will be some response to it. Yes? Well, if you, I don't know how you measure, necessarily measure response to it. I mean, I think these we give empirically. Well, we empirically vaccinate someone, you know, if they haven't been vaccinated within a couple of years of their diagnosis and going on stuff, we would recommend a revaccination. I mean, we do assume that even with vaccinations that some individuals may be more immunocompromised than others, and, you know, the other part to managing infections is to have a lower threshold for calling with warning signs of infection. And from our side of the phone, we're just more likely to start people on antibiotics. I mean, I usually make sure that people have either Levaquin or azithromycin available. If someone is having a low-grade fever without any localizing signs, if their counts are relatively stable, I will sit tight. If someone has any evidence that they're starting to, you know, cough or develop yellow or even or green sputum or burning when they urinate, then we'll empirically start antibiotics. Plasmacytomas, little or nothing was said of this. How frequent are they? So a plasmacytoma is just an anatomic term. It refers to a collection of plasma cells. So when we do x-rays in people with myeloma, if we see bone damage, you know, the punched out lytic lesions, each one of those lesions represents a plasmacytoma. I mean, we assume that this is a systemic disease. If we look in the bone marrow in the femur or the iliac crest, you know, in someone with systemic disease, we will see plasma cells. Looking at percentage involvement, though, is the least reliable way to quantitate this disease, so it's only part of the workup. And the only place that percentage involvement is used is in establishing the diagnosis. We don't look at percentage involvement as part of staging. So by definition, a collection of plasma cells is a plasmacytoma. There are rare individuals who present with what are called solitary plasmacytomas. So these are people typically who present with a symptom, typically back pain, who on imaging may have an abnormality that's biopsied and looks like and consists of plasma cells. So we call that a plasmacytoma. When we work people up in that setting, if they don't have disease anywhere else, we call that a solitary plasmacytoma. Less frequently, individuals can present with a solitary extraosseous plasmacytoma. That's typically in the nasopharynx. We can sometimes see it in other glands or organs, and this is much rarer. The literature for solitary plasmacytomas is that if you do more investigation, and typically we do some sort of whole body imaging, we can empirically do an MRI of the spine, or now one of the things that we like to do is a PET CT, which is a whole body imaging. If at the end of the workup the marrow is negative, the rest of the imaging is negative, and the plasmacytoma, as far as we can tell, is localized in one area, then the approach is to radiate that plasmacytoma to a higher dose, typically above 4250 centigrade. And if you do that and the protein they have disappears after 4 half-lives, then that may be all the treatment that individual needs. More commonly, what we see is someone may have more damage in one of their bones, but they do have damage elsewhere, in which case you can call the area of more damage a plasmacytoma, but that's in the context of systemic disease. Yes?
Do
So plasmacytomas are not a separate disorder. It's just an anatomic description of a collection of plasma cells, which most people with systemic disease have. So this is for Dr. Richardson, but I will do my best to answer it in the King's English. What exactly is randomization in a clinical trial setting? What are the pros and cons? So we have dozens of clinical trials, trials are sort of described by where they, oh, there's Dr. Richardson. Trials are sort of described by where they are along in the process. So a phase one study is typically is looking at a drug that has shown promise, and what we're trying to do is figure out the right dose of the chemotherapy. So typically, we enroll patients on dose levels. We look to see how it's tolerated. We obviously also look for response, and that's the study that we set the dose at. A phase two study is a study where we actually take what we consider the right dose and then look for response. And then a phase three study is a study where we compare that drug or combination of drugs with what we consider a standard of care. So in our randomized studies, basically the randomization is done by computer. In many of the randomized studies, people know which arm they're getting randomized to. There are double-blinded studies, for example, in the CLGB study, looking at the role of Revlimid maintenance post-transplant, it was a double-blinded study. So everyone got transplanted, and then they were randomized to Revlimid or placebo between days 90 and 100. It would be unethical to give a placebo to someone who needs to be treated. So we would never ask someone to go on a study who needed to be treated where there was a 50% chance that they would not receive treatment.
And I just would add to that that on that particular trial, which both Robbie was our principal investigator and we both participated, that trial was carefully monitored. So as soon as there was a signal that in fact the Revlimid did better than the placebo, which in fact turned out to be the case, we stopped, and those patients who were on the placebo arm were unblinded and immediately had access to the Revlimid. And as I mentioned earlier, I agree with Robbie, placebo-controlled trials in our disease are difficult and challenging, and we would never use them either in a situation where treatment was needed and there was quote unquote no therapy to the placebo arm. The other time we use placebo is if we're using a backbone of drugs, say two or three drugs, plus an add-on, and it's really not clear what that add-on may do, but always we request early looks so that if we see benefit, we stop, and therefore patients are not denied access to that drug. And sometimes trials fail, actually, and they are examples of why sometimes a randomized trial is very helpful, where you'll see a clinical benefit, or you'll presume there's a clinical benefit, and it turns out not to be the case. So, obviously, sometimes we always emphasize the success stories, but we also have studies where, in fact, the benefit isn't seen, and that can be an issue.
Is there an assumption that all myeloma patients have all the markers that the monoclonal antibodies are designed to target, or are patients tested for markers? That's a great question. So, for example, one of the defining structures on a plasma cell is CD38 and 138. So we know by definition that if someone has myeloma, we've gone through those, the plasma cells are going to express those structures on their surface. We did participate in an earlier study looking at CD56. This was a study sponsored by Immunogen, and it was looking at an anti-CD56 monoclonal antibody conjugated to a toxin. About 60 to 75% of myeloma cells express CD56, so as a prerequisite for this study, we actually had to do a marrow. We had to do flow cytometry, and only patients who were expressing CD56 were eligible to proceed on the trial. So that's an example of a marker that not everyone may express, and where, as a condition of going on the study, we have to define that it's present on the plasma cells.
Yeah, and to echo that, I think that the thing about CD38 is it's only on malignant plasma cells. It's not expressed on normal plasma cells, which is critical. And I think the other thing to share is elotuzumab, which you heard a lot about, the CS1 or SLAMF7 target is also only on malignant plasma cells, typically not on others. So the good news about those antibodies is that the target is universally expressed in myeloma, compared to the CD56 targeting approach, which Rob was alluding to, which is probably it's about what, a half to two thirds.
Correct.
Yeah.
So a slide on integrative therapies presented stated that massage therapy was often contraindicated for myeloma patients. I'm not sure it's contraindicated. Whenever we refer people for complementary therapies at the Farber, we do have to medically clear them. And, you know, we want to reduce the risk of people having bruising or bleeding if they're having massage or acupuncture. So for people with very low platelets or who are on anticoagulation, obviously we don't want them getting worked over by our acupuncturist or our massage therapist. So there's no mystery to it. We're trying to keep everything safe. We don't discourage people from pursuing this. We actually encourage it, but we also don't want to create problems where people are having bleeding or bruising due to low platelets or anticoagulation.
You have not really nothing to add to that other than I think the Larissa wanted me to emphasize that she apologized for not talking about the chiropractic bit, but I think the question from the lady here was perfect, that chiropractic practice in myeloma needs to be approached with great caution, but therapeutic massage, as Rob alluded to, is benign and great. And of course, just to reiterate, we're firm believers in the use of emollient creams to fingers and toes to help with neuropathy.
That's why Dr. Richardson's office smells like cocoa butter in the morning. The multi-drug approach was stressed this morning. I'm considering a prozimib trial, just low-dose dex to manage nausea. Why change the thinking to fewer drugs?
That's great. Thank you, Rob. You know, that's a great question. Now, I would say one thing about a prozimib. It's so potent. It's probably the most potent proteasome inhibitor ahead of merizumib that we've used. We've seen patients in whom three, four drug combinations have unfortunately been failing them, and we've exposed them to aprozumib, and they've benefited. The challenge with aprozumib, as Rob and I have both run headlong into, is the GI side effects. And we're just much more hopeful that with this current schedule and the use of dexamethasone, it's more manageable. What I would hope for the particular patient asking this question is that if aprozumib doesn't work, there's some fallback positions after that. Having said that, for those patients who tolerate aprozumib, we've been very struck that they respond not only well, but it's durable. So probably well worth the try at this point, as long as there are fallback positions that are reasonable, and with the recognition that obviously, you know, there is a certain risk involved, but that's inherent to any therapy.
Any more questions before we wrap up?
Okay.
Yes. So we all have different styles, but our primary goal is to take the best possible care of people. And we can do that by clinical trials, we can do that by conventional. You know, we work very closely with our colleagues in the community. There's the internet. We encourage people to ask questions, to participate in their care, to help us make decisions. There's more than one way to skin a cat. And my approach is to present the different options, the pros and cons, and make a decision together that person feels comfortable with the understanding that whatever we proceed with, there are going to be two things that we need to see to continue. One is that they're responding, and two, that side effects are acceptable and manageable. We're trying to take better care of people, and you know, if we just give them, conventional drugs, we're not going to advance our understanding. We're not going to come up with better treatments. You know, you heard from Dr. Avigan exciting stuff using dendritic cell fusions and immune manipulation. I think the other thing, our other mandate is to understand this disease better. We have a precursor clinic where we're trying to accumulate basically a library of molecular abnormalities and correlate that with how people do clinically. I think, you know, if there is no single best next step for that individual, then we present the choices and we come up with a plan that they feel most comfortable with.
But and as I understand the question, though, was also that it's, you know, recognizing, I completely agree with Rob, we that's what we seek to do as a mission here. The question is, how do you get that out into the community? Exactly. Yeah. Right. Well, yeah, no, understood. And I think that that's obviously a burning question. The issue then becomes, what advocacy do we have? And as I showed on our slide, obviously we've got the IMF, who are fantastic in my view, MMRF are also superb, and into the bargain, Leukemia Lymphoma Society. So there are those networks that are helpful. We have our own website, which is, we hope, helpful. And having the ability for people to come and see us is also key. We, for example, see patients, Rob and I see patients from all over New England, and we work with the local oncologists. What you raised, though, is a very interesting point, because in the last decade, our ability to get out and educate local providers has been substantially changed by kind of crazy regulations that have kind of, I think, to excuse the term, Rob said skinning the cat, I would use a slightly different term for this metaphor, they've kind of thrown out the baby with the bathwater. We're not allowed to go and talk to community doctors in the way that we used to at all, by virtue of various regulations that have really, I think, blunted our ability to educate. So we've got a few challenges on our hands, and I think that your point is very well taken. Having said that, for an immediate solution for you, I'd recommend the websites at IMF, MMRF, Rob, any others you find very helpful?
No, I think those are the best.
Yeah. And LLS as well.
But, you know, my practice is made up of two groups of individuals. There are people I follow directly, and there are people that I help the local physician manage. You know, I think it's always a good idea to come for a consultation, to get plugged into the system, establish a relationship. And, you know, that doesn't mean you have to come back. But it does mean that we know you. We communicate with the referring oncologist by carbon copying. You know, we're always accessible. If your local provider has questions, they should feel free to reach out to us, and we're not shy to give advice.
Yeah, I think that's a great point. So what we typically do exactly what Rob says. We'll see a patient in consultation, and then we don't have to see them every 3 or 4 weeks or even every 6 weeks. We can see them every 3 months, every 6 months. And the metaphor I use for that is, you've got your local Tom Brady, and then hopefully you need a sort of Bill Belichick, and here we are.
So. Yeah, I think my BMI is closer to Bill Belichick's than it is to Tom Brady.
So is mine. I seem similarly up here. So, yes.
Have you noticed a change in the demographics of people who get myeloma? I ask because all the reports I got 2 years ago showed the African American male over 64, and I just have noticed a lot of.
Yeah, that's a great, great question. We've learned so much more about the demographics. The reason that, this clearly is a disease of ancient peoples, and it is a disease of not just West Africa, because obviously the first signal in the African American community came and led to the assumption that this was a West African disease. It isn't. It's a Pan-African disease. It's also a disease in the Middle East and around the Mediterranean. So it is literally a disease of ancient peoples, because Homo sapiens migrated out of Africa and around. So they're very interesting theories. The disease is more common in the Mediterranean peoples, Italians, Greeks. I know clearly it's more common in people, there have been very sophisticated studies done in Israel, and it is more common in the Israeli population, but it is significantly more common in the Ashkenazi population compared to the Sephardic. With my Israeli colleagues I work with, they feel it's probably also more common in the Middle East, but the Arab countries are less sophisticated, frankly, in their ability to detect the disease and the population way that they are in Israel. So there's very complex sort of demographies that are involved. Having said that, there are also clearly environmental factors. For example, off the coast, the Solomon Isles, off the coast of Australia, there are high incidence in Pacific Islanders of the disease, but that's probably related to the atomic testing that occurred there in the 50s. Conversely, in Hiroshima and Nagasaki, myeloma did not emerge as a marker disease, but that's probably because the Japanese inherently are less vulnerable to this illness than other peoples. But there are population studies now from Taiwan that show a fivefold increase in the illness in the last 25 years, and in particular groups, agricultural workers, probably for exposures to pesticides and herbicides, and interestingly and somewhat sort of soberingly, in healthcare providers, which is fascinating why, but that's obviously a Taiwanese-based study. What we know in our practice, because Robbie and I share patients who are Vietnam vets, is that Agent Orange exposure is very real. And that's a particularly important environmental toxin. So I think in terms of the epidemiology of the disease, it's more complex. It is definitely more common in people of African heritage, but it is also more common in other heritages. Furthermore, it's environmentally driven by certain factors. And I think it's fair to say that we think the incidence of the illness is increasing. There were studies done at the Mayo that suggested it had plateaued and it was just a function of aging. I think in fairness, that may apply to the Olmsted County population that they studied. But I think if you look at it more broadly and more internationally, its incidence is clearly increasing. Okay. Great. Okay. Rob, I think that's it.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Good afternoon, everyone. Have a lovely holiday season. Yeah. Good.